I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Pretoria for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Pretoria.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Pretoria.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Pretoria as a whole, as really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home, away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Pretoria for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Pretoria.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Pretoria.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Pretoria as a whole, as really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home, away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Fort Hare.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Fort Hare.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Fort Hare as a home. It's really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Fort Hare.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Fort Hare.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Fort Hare as a whole. It's really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they've granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They've managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Fort Hare.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Fort Hare.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Fort Hare as a home. It's really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home, away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they've granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They've managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Fort Hare.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Fort Hare.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Fort Hare as a home. It's really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home, away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
For their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Fort Hare.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Fort Hare.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Fort Hare as a whole, it's really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers.
For always just being there for us as students.
for their support.
They have managed to support me financially, spiritually, and emotionally in all areas of life.
So I would really encourage everyone to come to Kote.
It's quite a cool experience to be part of it.
Because of the diversity and the support and all the incredible people we get to meet at Kote.
The school offers all the resources that you require for you to succeed in everything that you do.
The University of Kote as a home, as really a home.
They are friendly and they are kind and they are welcoming.
Being at UFH, it's a different story. You are home away from home.
Had I not come here, I wouldn't be here today.
I would like to take this opportunity and thank all my lecturers and also thank the University of Fort Hare for this wonderful opportunity that they have granted me.
For encompassing me with an education.
For the great support that they've shown throughout my whole academic years.
For giving me this opportunity to be who I wanted to be from a very young age.
And I'm so grateful to all my lecturers
for always just being there for us as students.
All be seated. A very good afternoon to everyone. My name is Ellen. I'm the Buhlungu to give us welcoming and opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rungani. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. That's better. Thank you very much, and thanks for making it for this fifth Archbishop Makgoba annual lecture. First of all, just to acknowledge, I'm going to do it in reverse, to acknowledge the students who are here, the staff of the university, academic and non-academic, to acknowledge the lecturers, the professors, to acknowledge the deans, Dean of Faculty in particular, Professor Lizil Celia, HODs that are in the house, DVC Prof Vital, good afternoon, Dr. Taulem Jimba, good afternoon, DVC Registrar. Also, just allow me also to acknowledge four other people. I'll keep it very short. I would like to acknowledge Dr. Pumezulpuana, a former member of council of the university, who's now the chairperson of the council. Dr. Pumezulpuana, to also welcome I'm going to make this special, and I'm going to ask him to stand for a reason, very specific reason.
Miss Alice, broken and breaking still. That's what it means. Crime. Nothing happens. Nothing moves.
Yeah? That's while we're talking about local economic development, what we see in our town, the birthplace of this university, we see the opposite. And we need to talk about that. We need to talk about that. We need to kind of put on a scale the big flowery language and all the political statements versus the reality. I could even move to talk about Bisho. another town, another home of this university. Bishop is a ghost town. It's a dead town. It's dead. Dead. Talk local economic development in Bishop? What does that mean? And you can even move to East London, talk about local economic development. You don't see it. You see drugs. You see drug dens. You see crime. In this month, every day, I'm reminded, as we talk about local economic development, for some reason, I'm reminded that last year we stood here on a platform like this and spoke, and we were hurt. Our student had been murdered. At the memorial service at Makgoba, Miriam Makgoba, I said something about drugs and, you know, this thing we cannot. A politician called me that afternoon. A politician with 2 feet, ne? Called me and said, I did not like your statement. Politician. Mr. Mosan, please honor us with your thoughts and your wisdom and your experience. Thanks for gracing this occasion.
Thank you very much, as usual. He thanks people to take the job of the vote of thanks. He's consistent. We also have colleagues and students who are watching the live stream, so we are welcoming them also. Now we're going to listen to a video that is going to give us the background of this lecture.
Members of the University Council, the principal, and Vice Chancellor, Professor. Yes. Members of the University Council, the Principal and Vice Chancellor, Professor Sakhela Buhlungu, our esteemed guest speaker, Mr. Luvuyo, Mosana, Deputy Vice Chancellors, Deans, the Program Director, students, friends, ladies and gentlemen, good evening or good afternoon, and welcome to this Archbishop Thabo Makgoba Development Lecture hosted at the University of Fort Hare. It is wonderful to be connecting with you virtually, although Professor Buhlungu knows that my heart, my head, and my soul longs to be with you in person. But due to circumstances beyond my control, I am unable to join you for this lecture. And I'm sorry for that. In this Women's Month, we are indeed proud of all women, particularly at Fort Hare, who continue to make meaningful contributions to our society. We are equally saddened by the daily attacks and abuse of women and girls in our different communities. And I pray that we will not only in words resolve to do something about it, but we will practically bring an end to such a scourge. My task this evening is very simple, and it will not take me long before you are introduced to the person that you really came here to listen to. As one of the trustees of the Archbishop Makgoba Development Trust, I'm here to briefly tell you about the trust and what the purposes of the trust and the lecture. The Makgoba family and other trustees launched this trust in 2012 as a small grant-making body to deal with some of the legacies of the past. Its formation has its roots in the needs expressed on a daily basis to me by individuals and community projects, people who write to me as Archbishop or show up at the gates of Bishop's Court asking for assistance. And they remind me that each time I pray for food, I say, God, make us ever mindful to those that do not have and responsive to their need. So the trust is really, in a small way, a response to the need of those people. So the nature of those needs has influenced the trust fundraising strategy and its choice of beneficiaries in grant making. The three legacy areas of the trust are food security, social justice, and education. Over the last 10 years, the trust has made a significant impact in these areas, and we have extended support to individuals, institutions, and communities to pursue their educational and developmental goals, with a special focus on those in financial distress. This lecture falls in the legacy area of education. It is one of the seven lectures that the Trust supports here, of course, at Fort Hare, at Rhodes University, at the University of Limpopo, at the University of Mpumalanga, at the University of the Western Cape, Walter Sisulu University, and lastly, at the Nelson Mandela University. We are in conversation with the National University of Lesotho, and we hope they will join in. Again, my warm thanks to our speaker and to the university for partnering with the Trust in establishing this platform for dialogue. May you have a wonderful evening of robust engagement. As
you know, sometimes we undermine ourselves. In a world which is full of cruelty, the best thing you can do is to be kind to yourself first. Allow me to welcome the Acting Dean of Faculty of Management and Commerce, Professor Lizelle Silias, who is going to give an introduction of the guest speaker. Can we give a round of applause as she joins the stage?
Good afternoon, everyone. That's the problem if you're shorter than the director. You always have to bring the mic down a little bit. It is my pleasure to introduce and to welcome Mr. Luvuyo Mosana, who is the Chief Executive Officer at the Eastern Cape Socioeconomic Consultative Council, a public entity organization whose vision it is to see a prosperous and productive Eastern Cape where all people realize their potential. He is responsible for facilitating policy strategy and technical dialogue with stakeholders on socioeconomic development issues, designing and facilitating implementation of strategies and interventions aimed at growing the economy, creating jobs, and combating socioeconomic disparities. He also designs and packages strategic development and or infrastructure projects for resources leveraging from government, state-owned entities, and the private sector. He also manages and leads consultants and contractors to ensure timely and efficient program implementation. Mr. Mosana earned a master's degree in politics and political economy from the Nelson Mandela University. He is also an alumni of the University of Fort Hare, so we welcome you back today. He graduated with a Bachelor of Social Sciences degree, I think it was 1991, and has also completed training on strategic planning and management at the University of the Witwatersrand, public service management, and public budgeting and fiscal management in Sweden, and organizational development at the New School for Social Research at the University in New York. Prior to me joining Fort Hare, Mr. Mosana was also my boss. He was the CEO of the East London Hospital Complex, yes. While I was a HOD there in the physiotherapy department. I think he left a year before me. So it's my absolute pleasure and my absolute honor to welcome you to take the stage and to share your thoughts with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The first thing is to adjust my eyes to the room and be able to see that these bright lights are not going to affect and impact me in any way. Prof. Celia would know that in our conversations over the past week, I indicated that we could not share this platform with you because I unfortunately had to undergo an eye procedure. Not a very hectic one, though. Good afternoon. It is quite a singular pleasure and honor to really be invited for this type of task. And especially when the task relates to such luminaries like the Archbishop. But I must say, when the task was shared with me and when I was requested to take upon this responsibility, I actually asked myself questions. And we will deliberate on those questions. As the VC had said, let us share and share knowledge and share experiences. But I will firstly ask your permission to be unorthodox. As they would say in the jazz world, let me be unplugged. If you follow the jazz world language, to be unplugged, it means the guitarist is going to really play from the heart. So the notes that I've put together, they will not necessarily be the ultimate guide of what I say. And if I say things, visage, that might really make you to receive another call, it was not my intention. And being unplugged means that I can say things that might be a bit annoying and a bit frustrating to others. But let me start by greeting, firstly, to the Arch in his absentia, knowing that he is with us virtually. And as I've said, Archbishop, it is a singular honor for me to be at this particular platform and to be asked to share ideas, views regarding this very important topic, local economic development. And I may say, it's a topic that I relate with and I have very close passion to, for it is something that I did not only study, but I have also been in practice. I pass my greetings also to the DVCs of the university. And I see University of Fort Hare is now having quite a number. And I say, VC, indeed, some of us who whisper in the corners talking about you and the university. Yes, we do. We do talk about you. We actually make the appreciation of the strides you're making, particularly for us who come from this university. We are very proud of the developments that we are seeing. Looking at the leadership cohort that you've pulled together, and for them to have been able to accept joining this institution is an indication of that good leadership. So, greetings to all of your DVCs. I know there are a couple of new ones as we introduce them. We've read about them also as well. I also want to extend a special greeting to Andiyazike umuntu omdala kuyakwazi ukuthi wesibali nakuye. But uBele has tended to give me that privilege. For those of you who grew up in the Eastern Cape, particularly in the border region, he is not just one of the senior clergies. He's an activist that has been with us around the border region here in the Eastern Cape. He led us in many marches, if you were to think about it, in the 80s. And I don't know whether he would remember incidents after the funeral of the late Mamum Klenge, I actually went to hide in Stutterham because I couldn't stay in East London where I actually reside. The realities were that I would have been arrested or killed for reasons that are known best by those who were leading the system then. So at the time, the priests in the area, they were actually responsible to help us to go through and be hidden in best places. There is an Ashe family, and unfortunately, Mem Ashe passed on, and his son, Sindiso, passed on. They gave me quite a very good, you know, a welcome and safety in the area of Stutterham. Anyway, let's leave those and come back. So, greetings to you, and as well as greetings to the chairperson from Fort Cox College. We really are proud to have people who keep their association with the university. Where do I start? Maybe some of you are starting to ask questions. Why is this fellow carrying two books? And what is the reason of these two books? The one is a seminal book, Reverend Nsingwa, Time Longer Than Rope. How many of you have read this book? I know a couple of the professorate would know the book. The one is, other one is The Struggle for the Eastern Cape by Martin Legaski. Both Eddie Roo and Martin have actually written very seminal work in the history of the struggle of the oppressed people of South Africa. But I will, in the course of the reflections and sharing this knowledge, directly raise what I thought I should share as I was preparing for this lecture. And this thought actually came up when I was getting quite deeper to appreciate your father's work. Ark is not here, so I'm going to refer to you. As I was reading his biography, as is available in the internet, there are a couple of things that I actually noted and I felt they needed to be appreciated. Amongst those is the work, or rather, his journey in the education space. Interestingly, a person who comes from the science world traverses the education space right through and ends up in the space of religion. You might be asking yourselves questions. What is it exactly? But for those of you who know the golden circle, they would understand indeed the logic behind. And what I found fascinating as well is the mention of his PhD work and the fact that he has had relationships with such important organizations like the Alan Gray School for Values at UCT. I'm sure most of the young people in the university and in other universities, when you think about Alan Gray, they think about an organization whose investment and support of developing our best of minds in business, particularly entrepreneurial work, is actually quite commendable. His association really sparked my mind. But secondly, there are certain questions that he seems, and it's so unfortunate to be talking about him as though he is not here in this platform. There are questions that he seems to have answered with a particular inner self-reflection than just a knee-jerk reaction to a question that is being asked. Amongst these, being asked about the question of lesbians and as well as, or rather, marriages between lesbians within the religious community. And as a clergy, he responds with a very firm indication of appreciation of diversity. A very important principle that all human beings should really be espousing: diversity. And indeed, he then takes me, when I read those, to go back and revise my own understanding of what Eddie Roo had said some time and years ago. For those who have not known him, Eddie Roo is a former Communist Party member in South Africa. For years, back in the early 20s, and he happened to have been a botanist from the University of Witwatersrand. But he has written quite a lot of history, and profoundly this book in particular, and the different editions of it. And I just want to quote, to relate the point to what he says about the change and transformation of society. And on page 77, he says, "It is an interesting fact that the first Bantu mass movement on truly national lines was a religious one." And I want just to end on that quote. I'm sure some of you are asking the question, why would you want to bring this quote? You would want to relate again the same with a writing by Legasiki. Martin Legasiki, in pages 6 to 7, makes an appreciation particularly about the role of the missionaries in the history of development of firstly ideas and as well as shaping of the movements or resistant movements for liberation of South Africa, and particularly focused on the Eastern Cape. Many of them he mentions by name and quotes the work that they did, but particularly exciting here, it is an Anglican missionary who left the comfort of his home in Europe and came to do sterling work within the Eastern Cape. And with that work, a followership of many scholars emerged. So the intellectual work in this southern part and the eastern part of South Africa can be claimed from the work of these missionaries as well. Yes, indeed, they are earlier intellectuals, but these were the most illuminous ones that we are able to relate to their written work. The point for me, there are experiences that we need to learn from the development of these intellectuals, as well as there are experiences that we need to unlearn. Please note these two words. Learning and unlearning and relearning are going to be very critical in all what I say this afternoon. But let me start by moving out of appreciating Bishop Makgoba's work Archbishop Makgoba's work, and including the very beautiful focus areas that he has elected for his trust, and which I think the trustees were very foresighted when they chose these particular areas, and which he spoke to earlier, and I will not repeat them. Let's frame our mindsets again, much more closer to what we have to deal with. I spoke in passing about what I call the golden circle. Some of you, and most of you, who have the opportunity to log in into such sites like the very famous one, where you get all of these YouTube videos on lectures and lectures and lectures, and I hope data is available for students to log into those sites. And this particular one that I came across, I'm not going to mention for a reason, because I want people to think through what exactly is the site, so that you go and research about it. There is a very interesting writer and a young person by the name of Simon Sinek. Please get the students to get to that site. Simon Sinek writes three very interesting books for me, and I'm going to be talking about those as I proceed. The first one is Finding Your Why. We're talking about leadership of local economic development. Finding Your Why. And the second book, beyond these two books that deal with the why question, is a book titled Leaders Eat Last. Leaders Eat Last. Ndiye ke ndiyenze a joke lento xa ndincokola ke mfundisi. Ndithi pha emakhaya injoli ngabantu apha babaluleke kakhulu. When the whole beast has to be divided to the entire community, injoli is the one who actually ensures that all of the relevant pieces of meat are in the right dishes. In the Xhosa tradition, you don't just put any piece of bone to any dish. There is attached meaning to every other piece of meat you put in the dishes. But take time to get closer to that injoli and see what's happening in the actual dish of injoli. He's usually not the only person, they are a team. They usually carry the best of sharpest knives. Follow their dish. Their dish is usually with all of the good, relevant pieces of meat. And in good proportions, see? Because they must ensure that as they have dispersed the dishes to the firstly the family, and secondly the elders of the village, and all of the other categories of people, they give them the relevant pieces in their visible form. Here is a trick. Injoli and the team do not start eating before people eat. They wait for the entire community of people to eat. And it's only then that you'll find them kneeling down, getting to their dish. Because they want to ensure that people are able to ask the question and actually that they answer to the question. Uphi uqhongo kwesi sithebe? Siphi isifuba kwesi sithebe? Archbishop Makgoba says, let's find African solutions to African problems. That's what he said, here and now. So we've always had solutions to problems that we seem confronted with and as though we don't have a history of our own. I'm going to be talking to that later on. But let's come back to Simon Sinek. For this particular purpose, Simon Sinek says, in everything we do, we must start with a why. The how and the what are very easy to answer, but dealing with the purpose is actually the essence of what you're actually going to be dealing and resolving. Leaders for local economic development. Do they understand their why? Maybe it's a very wrong question to be asking. Maybe it's a very wrong question to be asking. But to be elected and put into positions of responsibility, amongst other things, and the first to do is to establish this why. And there's a two sides in it. It is a why about yourself, because the purpose that you are an existing human being on this earth must be about something. And if anything, go to the scriptures, you will find answers. I'm not very strong in the scriptures. Reverend knows this, and I know a joke that was made by a priest and one of the political leaders locally. I was on a flight with them to Cape Town, the late Mluleki George and Reverend Finger. With Reverend Finger, we served in the interim council of Walter Sisulu, so we're going to meet the minister. And Mr. George, the former deputy minister of defense, asks the priest, have you managed to convert this young boy? And remember at the time, Mr. George was already a udodana, a wisile, you know? And having been himself the communist who actually taught us at our young age the dialectical materialism, it was quite interesting to hear him ask this question. And my answer was simple, that the journey you have undertaken is probably a journey that I will undertake, but allow me for now to be appreciative of the tools that you gave me for analysis. The books of St. Joseph do mention that God entrusted men with the responsibilities of nurturing the earth. And I usually interpret this loosely and say, we've been given the responsibility to be principals on earth. And we are accountable, certainly, from a religious point to the Almighty for having to do in accordance with his values that which must be done on earth. I'm sure most of you know that simple prayer. But also, if the why then has any meaning, if we are going to be able to nurture and take care of what is happening on earth, the responsibility is quite wild and big. Because what is happening on earth has a combination of many interconnected activities. A bigger ecosystem that we must be able to relate with quite responsibly. So, Colossians chapter 3 also speaks about whatever we do, we must put our hearts in it. So, finding this why and being able to understand the why of the bigger organizations that we belong to is a critical path of the knowledge of our existence, but also the knowledge of what we do in developing ourselves and developing our communities. I really think that in these discussions, we will definitely find our why, and particularly the why of the leadership of local economic development. Having said all of these introductory remarks about the topic of today, let me come back to the actual topic and firstly draw the context within which this economic development would be taking place or is or has to be taking place within. The crisis, and crises as in plural, and disruption caused by COVID-19 to human development index are in themselves far and beyond the recent 2008 economic crisis. And the current shifting geopolitical tectonic plates caused by the Russian war, which further exacerbate the existential well-being of all economies. And that's a reality of what we are confronted with. Leave COVID-19, come closer to what the Ukraine-Russia war is causing to us here locally. Prof, you're talking about local economic development, that is not happening here. The employees of the auto sector in East London, they are currently on short time. Why? Because the supplies of goods that come from Europe aren't able to reach our shores because of the disruptions of the war. No longer COVID. Yesterday it was COVID. Today it is the war. You can go to other commodities and the impact and the implications of what is happening in terms of our cost of living to date. And you realize that indeed we're an interconnected world and a world that we must be able to appreciate whatever shifts that are happening in it. But certainly, as the going says, from all crises, there is a silver lining of opportunities for creativity and innovation. The task is to find that silver lining. Two words, creativity and innovation. How do we find that? And I will later on talk about the role of higher education institutions in finding those solutions. And remember, we are talking about leadership of local economic development. The global social and economic village is in an intellectual interregnum and coalesces on learning, unlearning, and relearning through generating knowledge from the crisis about the threats to human security, how to lead emerging futures, developing methodologies and toolkits for anticipatory innovation, along with rethinking transformation systems and catalytic actions towards achieving the sustainable development goals and building organizational resilience. Sure, topics that you deal with every day in the academia. You are a knowledge institution. You generate knowledge every other day. And I may say, if anything, we need to be able to understand the future that we want to build and bring it forward right now, so that our innovation then is enabling us to put together actions that catalyze that future to happen. Think it about differently. If you have children, we all have ambitions for them to become this and the other. But if not nurtured from an early age at kindergarten, you have a major struggle to deal with them at adolescence. I'm sure most of you have read Erikson's socio-psychological development of human beings and understand the various steps that he talks about. And by understanding them, I'm sure we then understand the important phases of human development that we need to be able to arrest at the beginning to be able to ensure that we get to the greatest impacts and outputs that we should be having. And in this case, I'm making these examples because it is this anticipatory innovation and developing the toolkits for that. I once had an opportunity to be called visiting a lecturer. I can't remember what the right terminology was at Border Technical. And I was with management students. Well, I looked at the curricula and I asked them, particularly those who are doing the exit courses, which is your level 3, or the 3rd years, if you put it in a similar language. Ask them, what are the topics of your research? I found quite very startling information that they were researching on things that are far out of the realities that they live in. It's not a joke what you see on WhatsApp. We've learned a lot about locusts, whilst others were learning about interventions that they need to resolve challenges that confront them. I will be coming back to what other scholars raise about this, and there's a very interesting one that I've come across recently, but he has written his article quite a little earlier, I think it was 2015. In characterizing the crisis, the UNDP in its 2022 special report titled New Threats to Human Security in the Anthropocene is saying and is arguing that COVID-19 has caused unprecedented decline in the Human Development Index, and specifically between the years 1990 to 2021, they indicate even with the 2008 global crisis, we did not see a decline in the Human Development Index. But certainly with COVID, the disruptions were such that we have now seen a decline, declining between 2018 down to 2021 to a level between 7 and 6, 0.7 and 0.6. Very serious decline. But the COVID-19 impacts goes well beyond this distressing record. School closures and restrictions on people's movement having disrupted the education of millions of children worldwide, with resulting cost of learning still to be assessed. Many countries tend to remote learning, but an estimated two-thirds of the world's school-age children lacked internet access in their homes. This is a discussion that we had with VCs in one of the Human Resources Development Council, where we were asking universities to supply us with details of their interventions and response to COVID-19. And they responded indeed to these questions by also indicating to us that one of the greatest challenges they have in the online learning is connectivity and the availability of data. So COVID-19 has exacerbated many and made open many conditions that we have not understood that we needed to move faster on in our development space. The report, of course, characterizes the new generation of human security threats and proposes solutions to it. And amongst the solutions that it proposes in terms of the Anthropocene context is that we are seeing inequality, digital technology threats, health threats, and as well as violent conflict. But also, the solutions that they're talking about are solutions that put thrust at the helm. And with it, they are saying solidarity enables and promotes human agency. And they argue that human agency enables and promotes empowerment, and as well as human agency enables and promotes protection. The UNDP special report articulations can also be taken to confirm that aspirational transformation goals articulated in the UN, Sustainable Development Goals have been disrupted and further taken with what the other writers have raised, and which is both Lee and Wardock, that the challenges that are associated with the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals are wickedly complex and interconnected and require transformational change at a systems level. They are interconnected and they require transformational change at a systems level. So we can't be tinkering with these problems. We must think in systems terms. We must really find the solutions much more at a systemic and ecological ways. The ecosystem really must be understood in itself in order to be able to deal with this. The transformation agenda is not value-free and is not ahistoric to power relations, and including the fact that the disruptions themselves are unraveling the below-surface logic. What do I mean? You know, Prof. Buhlungu is a sociologist, and I never said this to him. At the time, he used to do research for trade unions. I think you were in Vets at the time, if I'm not mistaken. But I was working for a trade union called the Chemical Workers Industrial Union. I never mentioned this. Sorry to do it here. The underlying logic in Marxist terms has always been about the fact that all hitherto societies are class. And the reality is that what we're confronted with in the world is exactly about that. This is where I start to give troubles to you, Prof. I hope any Marxist terminology and language I use doesn't follow us. The analogies in various articles have tended to use the geographic terminologies, the Anthropocene, the tectonic plates, as metaphors for geopolitical conflict, rising tensions between the haves and the have-nots. Uba bendingayithetha njengesintu ndingathi hayi mfundisi siyazikhumsha ngokufakela terminologies in a language sophisticated instead of being clear about the problems we're confronted with and at the center of it. It's about the haves and the have-not. The maximization of accumulation by others at the expense of others. The war in Ukraine has caused seismic waves, radiation from the epicenter and impacting economies far and wide. The earthquake analogy is perhaps most apt because the war reveals a sudden shift in underlying geopolitical tectonic plates. The danger is that these plates will drift apart, fragmenting the global economy into distinct economic blocks with different ideologies, political systems, technology standards, cross-border payments and trade systems, and reserve currencies. All of us are talking about the dollarization of the world, and this has now been brought into the spotlight by this war. Probably we know much about the Cold War, but this has now become a bit of a coldest war, particularly for the West and the East Bloc. And certainly, we have a responsibility to build local economic development, isn't it? And we are going to come closer to this. The net result of these crises has been the exacerbation of country challenges, including fiscal challenges, which affect resourcing of transformation agenda. The debt to GDP ratio crisis in South Africa has become a record high. And I'm sure economists in the room would agree with me. If we sit at plus minus 70.7% in terms of the debt to GDP ratio, we have now far surpassed what initially economists and politicians have always understood and argued that we should not go beyond, which is 60% of the GDP debt ratio. Because when we said that, we said if we were to do so, there is a threat of losing sovereignty to the lending institutions. Wow, cool. Previously, we actually called them by names. But today, what's happening? IMF has its own institutional base in all of the countries now. They have here at home. A couple of years ago, as the crisis of energy was mounting higher, they actually gave us conditionalities in the relationship. Remember that? They said, fix Eskom, and these are the conditions for our relationship. Probably this time around, it might not be as easy to put such drastic programs as was the case before, like the structural adjustment programs. Because in themselves, they are threatened by the crisis in the manner that their institutional makeup and existence is being questioned and the role that they play. And I'm talking about all of the Bretton Woods institutions. This is the reality of the globe that we are in. And we're still coming to this local leadership. My apologies, I did say I will be unplugged. Because this local leadership must be able to relate to this. And if they don't relate to this logic, how do they deal with the development of the local economies? And of course, doing so in the appreciation that we are an interconnected world. The Mercedes-Benz we have in East London and VW we have in Port Elizabeth are a reflection of this interconnected world. The supplies that they get to these cars, they get from all of the European countries, most of them. And we need to ask the question, what does it take to develop a dashboard and door panels of a car? We are coming to this local economic development and asking these critical questions. One of the African scholars, Professor Vusi Gumede, argues that the best solutions to these global crises are embedded in the first step towards achieving lasting solutions entailing a deliberate program of action to unlearn, relearn, unthink, rethink dominant thought patterns which Africans and their leaders have acquired in the process of their encounters with the imperial powers over the last 500 years or so. Do you hear this fellow? Do you hear him? Am I making sense? The point he's raising is fundamentally important because we're not going to extricate ourselves from the crises if we do not start unlearning certain things, rethinking the dominant patterns. My apologies, I've reached the point. Babe kutwa nsenkonzweni bekuzawuthwa kutwa nemfundisi xa kutwa nyoka 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 mzalwane. I've reached the point, but the point is an emphasis that I need to be making that the new African development narrative needs to occur within a firm framework that acknowledges the African political leadership, much like African society, has suffered from learning and thinking incorrectly, concerning firstly itself and secondly the socio-economic development. Ubabe ndingayibeka in a simpler way. Tina sibambelele ku aprons of yesterday. Sijinga kuzo. We want to do and everything in the manner that our previous colonizers did. I don't find it difficult to relate with Mr. Mueletsi Mbeki when he makes these statements that our economy is really feeding into the North. I mean, I would find just one scholar who can write and tell us just about the raw materials that we produce in this country that are never beneficiated within this country. We said what? Local leadership for local economic development. The task is quite huge for this leadership cohort, I must say. And he, in a sense, he goes further and make many other points in his articulation, which talk about the need to then reformulate thinking and the need to rethink the way we, and the logic of development that we want to see. And having that being responsive to who we are. We can't have development that is not responsive to who we are. And he goes on to say, such must certainly include building local supplies for commodities already in demand, for an example, realizing the dream of the Eastern Cape. Actually, I say this point, which we always put up, that we want to become a food basket of the region. What does it mean to become a food basket? The Rwandan president, in the course of the Ukraine war, makes a pronouncement. I'm sure all of you have it on your WhatsApp. And he says, I'm going to ensure that we invest so many millions. If he didn't say billions, actually, I think he said billions, to turn around our agriculture and have our own food supplies. Doesn't take just to make such a big statement, but it takes a conscious realization that I was talking to someone. Do you know a plant called Ujongilanga and Funibiza ngesilungu? What is it? No, profs, please. Profs should not answer this. It's a sunflower. Why must Africa depend on Ukraine for such supplies? When we always shout louder that we are the ones who have the best of sun in the entire world. Where are we? We have the best of soils as well. This is a point that Vusiku Mede makes, and there's a point I'm making as well. And I'm saying further that we must be in ensuring that in that when we do extract and develop these local economies, we should protect our local endowments and ensure a responsible exploration that responds to environmental, social governance policy frameworks. Indeed. We must not take irresponsible actions. Success of Professor Kumede's argument can be reinforced by the methodologies offered in the discussion of topics on the threats to human security, particularly how to lead from emerging futures, developing methodologies and toolkits for anticipatory innovation. Let's leave this context. I've been talking about these leaders for local economic development in relationship to the context. But I've asked questions now. And unfortunately, Prof. Buhlungu, you asked me, VC, to be a keynote. I'm not used to keynotes. I'm used to conversations. And unfortunately, now you make me to speak before I engage ideas from the room, something that I'm used too much on to facilitate engagements than to be the one who speaks in front of others. And part of it in me is asking questions. And the first amongst these, now getting closer to the local economic development leadership. What must a leader of local economic development have to be one? The qualifier and by leader of local economic development. What qualifies me? Well, I argue that there are a couple of knowledge areas that need to be endowed in us to be these leaders. The first amongst those is the history of the people and the area. That's the first one. Most of you might know the method and tools called the asset-based community development. How many of our leaders know and use those tools? I know Forte in the business entity, you've been responsible for training NGOs on this. We worked with you and the NGO coalition. Have you reached out to all of the municipalities in the Eastern Cape? Have you created the scale and the mass for the knowledge of this particular methodology? Knowledge of the history of the area and its people. Asset-based community development tells you. Most of the academia in the room would have come across tools called your reach map data analysis. Indeed. And I'm sure if students have not come across, please give them these tools. This knowledge of your local people and the area includes, amongst others, knowing these assets. Do we know Ichume and the dams that are in the area? Can we characterize Ichume as a perennial river or a seasonal river? And if we characterize it and understand it as a perennial river, then therefore we understand what Ichume stands for in terms of our own development. In creating the agricultural conditions for planting and harvesting the crop that we need. This thing is not a complicated thing. For a fact, if you want to call and be called a leader, this is why I brought these books. I'm not a leader, but at least I have been made to be a scholar. The first present I got, which was not a present, actually, it was a way of getting me to discussion to establish whether I was serious in what I was getting to. You remember the old people that were banned into East London from Robben Island, from all over the Eastern Cape? The old man by the name of Chalman gave me this book. We're young students in the 80s. And he says, go and read this. We're excited. Forming an organization called COSAS Right Across. Go and read this book. And I mean, indeed, I went to read Time Longer Than Rope. And when we got back into discussion with these elderly people, they started, look, they never even quoted a chapter. Look how intelligent they were. In the course of discussion, they were able to determine that we have not read the book. And they then determine that you are not serious. But because we were so serious and we read these books, we were then able to, for them, graduate to be these serious young people that are really meaningful to what they believe is a revolution. And the point I'm making is to be and to seek to be called a local leader, you need to be able to immerse yourself in the knowledge of the area. The VC speaks about Alice, and I will take the entirety of the municipality. One of the old people who happened to also be our mentors, Ubaundro Makalim, before his passing away, he was a leader of a Communist Party in the Eastern Cape. Before his passing away, he had asked the Communist Party in the Eastern Cape. He had a farm on the river mouth of in the area of Fort Beaufort, just the river actual name I will remember now. And he says, comrades, here's a farm. Can you start experimenting with it on the development that we want? I feel so pity that we never approached Forte at the time, Prof, because I'm sure we should have been helped because it's a knowledge institution. I know for a fact we came later to come and establish. You remember Forte in the Eastern Cape is the leading institution on the cooperatives and the cooperative education and, you know, ideas. We only went to discuss that. In retrospect, I feel that we should have really taken the opportunity and we could have developed that farm. The second knowledge area for leadership, in line with the first one, is what are the local endowments? The Cut River Valley is known for what? For citrus. As a young fellow who grew up in East London, I knew in the June period we would be working at the harbor at the Stifidos, loading oranges on their vessels. So, for each area, there are specific endowments that we should be able to understand, but not just understand these endowments, but also thirdly, understand the products and the potential products from them and the value chains for these. We're talking local economic development. If a leader is unable to tell the value chains of citrus. If I can't wear as many color orange lions gem, where are we going? So, this is what we need. I'm still talking about knowledge. And the point about knowledge as well in terms of these value chains is the ability then to understand as to what are the capabilities that we need to apply to be able to deal with the different cogs of the value chain. Because it cannot be about we have oranges and the oranges are planted here, that's a primary production stage, and the oranges are transported here and they are shipped out. Can't be. The roles of local people in these value chains. Why must our people be seasonally employed? And I'm using citrus as an example. Why must they be seasonally employed when there are many value adds that we can put in to ensure that there is right true, year true employment in the particular sector? Again, knowledge. But this knowledge is not something that flies from the sky. There are knowledge-generating institutions that must help us with research. that must help us from that research with data that we must turn into information and ultimately the knowledge. Prof. Silas, I did say I'm a bit difficult person. I get unplugged. I might be taking too much of your time, but let me try and finish off by talking about two things. The first one is, what sort of capabilities do we need of these leaders? Probably, I spoke to this first capability, which is knowledge. But rather, competences, not capabilities. The competences that I want to talk to are based in the systems thinking and logic. And the first one is the ability to think in terms of systems and knowing how to lead systems. Oh, God. I feel like, Prof, when I went to meet one fellow looking to come back at Fort Hare to do my PhD, and I actually told him that I want to do a PhD, and my focus is really about how public service is not able to make an impact. And I was thinking about a systemic approach to the different departments of the public service in the province, and looking at where the problems are. And probably myself at the time read a lot of Plutchy's book, the chapter by David Everett and Sis Lulu, which was about integration. I must have read a lot about that and got excited, and the thought that I needed then to, you know, get to do a PhD and looking and focusing. Well, the fellow did laugh at me and said, "Ah, you're a bit crazy. You don't get material on what you want to do." The second competency, the ability to understand the variability of work in planning and problem solving. Hear me out. The ability to understand the variability of work in planning and problem solving. The third one, understanding how we learn, develop, and improve, and leading in true learning and improvement. You see, in life, we have a tendency and a perception that to do something, we must first perfect the idea before we even attempt it. And that's not what innovation requires. Do it, let's learn, fail quick, and then we move. Because we have learned. Improve, move on. The fourth one is understanding people and why they behave the way they do. Wow, very nice area in field. And the fifth one is understanding the interdependence and interactions between systems, variations, learning, and human behavior, knowing how each affects the other. And the last and the sixth one, leaders give vision a meaning, give direction, and focus the organization towards that direction. Please go to a book by a fellow called Peter Schultz, which is called The Leader's Handbook. He expatiates on this quite in detail. Lastly, here we are a higher education institution. What is our role in all of this thing that I've said? What is our role in all of what I said? And I want to start by saying, a leader in Vietnam called Ho Chi Minh, who led the Vietnamese Revolution, makes a very profound point, and he wrote, "A year begins with spring, a life begins with youth, Youth is the spring of society. Close quote. I hope you hear me. And he goes on in his article, which is about education. Enthusiasm, vitality, and creativity and creative capacity are the strengths and resources of youth. As the larger and powerful reserves and successor in the Vietnamese Revolution and the future masters of the country, the younger generation, first of all, youth, have to take responsibility to succeed the revolution caused and realize the glorious historical mission that their predecessors handed to them. The country will prosper or become decadent, stronger or weaker, depended very much on the youth. Ho Chi Minh affirmed that the youth had to be a major and steady force in the national resistance war and the national reconstruction process. Underline the national reconstruction process. They must give the revolutionary strength to the older generation and be in the front line of the economic and cultural development and building socialism process. That's Ho Chi Minh from Vietnam. And I'm sure as university, you would agree very much with what he says. And you are the actual platform and the base for creating this of young people. Let me end by not finishing all of these areas, but just end by some of the very easy points from a writer called Don Ruiz Manguel. And he writes a book called The Five Agreements. And he says in these five agreements, and I want this to also be a communication we make to our students here and now in the university, that be impeccable with your word. That's the first agreement. The second one, don't take things personal. The third one, don't make assumptions. Where you have made them, validate them. The fourth one, always do your best. And the last one, learn to listen. Thanks a lot. My apologies. I took long, and I know I accepted and you agreed with me that I will be unplugged, and I tried to stay as such. And of course, I was doing it because I'm also trying to avoid questions. Thank you. So I must go and declare. Thank you.
Let's give our keynote speaker another round of applause. While we are at unlearning things, I'm happy that the clergy is here, and we are tired, you know, when we go to churches and family gatherings, to always be asked, when are you getting married? But when we are at funerals, we have never asked the elders, when is your, are you also going? So isicelo bethunani, as we are in the Women's Month, the pressure is too much. May we go and send the message. I'm now going to invite any questions or comments so that we can engage our keynote speaker. There will be a moving mic. Okay, if noted, Prof. Nyamrindi. Yes, you can.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for a wonderful lecture. I enjoyed it because you tried to make us uncomfortable about certain things. And one of the things which I would like you to respond to is particularly at local government. In our RNA, we work with some of these municipalities you're encouraging us to talk to. And you hear them talk a lot about the fourth industrial revolution, when in their very own municipality, they are struggling to provide water, basic services, amenities, a reliable system in which people can even have their trash picked up and taken away. But document after document, you see them saying, we seek to be the municipality that drives the ideals of the fourth industrial revolution. And leading to that, then the question would be, what is your take on local development agencies? Here in East London, by the beachfront, we've got the Buffalo City Municipal Development Agency. A few meters away from the university campus in Alice, we've got the Raymond Mhlaba Development Economic Development Agency. What is your take on the vehicle of local development agencies in driving ideals of economic development?
Can I have a moving mic? Oh, there's one. Okay, one more.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Madam Program Director. And greetings to the dignitaries. My name is Sipamandla Fayaka. I'm a student here, University of Fort Hare, Alice campus. Mine actually is more common to that of Prof. There, to just question really the take on our speaker as in the time and the rather the time that has been taken by the government indeed, especially the local one, to improve the lives of the people in our society. Because honestly, today we may only have a few in the house, but we know that time after time, papers, speakers, people do share their frustration on what is going on in our country, our local areas, but seemingly there seem to be no implementation of what is being shared. Thank you very much.
May I request you to give Tata Luvuyo Mosana the mic so that he can respond.
Thanks a lot, Program Director, and thanks a lot for the questions. Let me start with the last one. There are areas in the talk that I have not spoken to, and amongst those is issues about governance. And amongst those is issues directly about service delivery and all of the areas of service delivery. Let me simplify this thing. She tells you that we worked in a hospital complex. As was the case in the hospital complex, all institutions and areas of services, they have norms and standards, isn't it? If you're talking about providing a service like water to a community, there are norms and standards for that. So if we don't go back to the normative and standards approach in terms of dealing with service delivery and planning it, then there will always be easy problems alongside. And these easy problems would relate to all of the other malfeasances that we talk about. Resources not being utilized appropriately and fully for what they are meant for. And all of those things. But if you were to really take from the norms and standards and develop service charters and commitments with the people, that's what we did at the hospital complex. We might have been in the newspapers for wrong reasons, but at least we did what we had to do. For the fact that we have an oncology today in East London, it was part of just appreciating this I'm talking about. So of all of these different services, that's the basic point. The next basic thing is having the requisite capabilities in place. Iman Umosana will never change from being a social science, person to becoming an engineer overnight. No. Where you require an engineer, have an engineer. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Basic. And then, the point, therefore, about implementation for me is really hindering around these things and the ability to deal with them and be upfront about them. and take those five agreements. For all leaders, the last points I've made, the five agreements. When we have developed plans, and we must develop these plans in a participatory process. Colleagues, there is a very good philosophical basis developed in South Africa, which is called the Integrated Development Plan. The Integrated Development Plan is not just a plan of this particular boundary area called a municipality A or B or C. It is the whole of government agreeing that these resources we will put in place for this particular area from all of the spheres for the development of the area. So IDPs and the participation of people in the IDP development must always be at the center of the promise we're making and the contract we're making with the people. Period. For my sins, I chose that topic for my thesis at UPE Nelson Mandela University. So I'm saying people have also a responsibility in this relationship. The white paper on local government had defined a municipality to be what we called a three-legged pot. It is council, it is administration, and it is communities. Simple. So if this pot were to stand, it is these three legs that must really be firm. None of them must be really, you know, limping. All right, I'll leave it at that. 4IR. Yes, my apologies for the laughter, but I've been in the local government space, and I know exactly what you're talking about. And we work in the institution I'm in with local government. It's indeed a period that we cannot run away from. We are in an interconnected world, as I said earlier on, and definitely we must deal with digital transformation in our spaces as we need. We know now in our days, our young people that are unemployed must be able to teach English in foreign countries without having gone out of South Africa on what you call the online learning and teaching that is developed with gig economy. So all of this e-commerce, in our days, we now have Uber Eats and everything. So we need this technological development. But in itself, it must be driven by the needs of the particular local areas. So please don't do it for the sake of it. Let's know what are the needs and let them drive it. But let's talk about the development agencies. These are very important institutions. Leave the history of how they developed from the IDC support, supporting them to come up in the different places. And indeed, at the time, I was still in local government when the IDC started to put these 800,000 for establishment of these entities. Here and now, remember, municipalities will never have the capability to recruit and have all of the requisite resources to be able to drive and promote trade and investment in their spaces. Remember, municipalities will never have the agility to deal with issues of land and property parcels that need to be transformed and redeveloped at the speed and pace that can be done, because they are bureaucracies in the first instance. So local development agencies have a responsibility to first be imbued with the requisite capabilities. They cannot be a mirror image of your LED units and operate in the same way as LED units. Because if they are such, then unfortunately, they are not what they are meant for. They must be the ones that would have the requisite skills to attract investors into those spaces. Of course, working with their municipal leadership as the leaders that they must account to. They must be the ones with the ability to attract skills of agricultural economists in the municipal space. The municipal structure that is the structure of a municipality in LED might not be able to. They might be the one who attract research to be able to tell us about these local endowments and how we put these value chains that I was talking about. And if they don't do that, sorry, they are in the wrong playing field.
Thank you very much. Are there any more comments? All right. Thank you so much. I will now call upon Prof. Ndabi Mjiba to the DVC Research Partnerships and Innovation to come and give us a vote of thanks. Can we give her a round of applause whilst she joins the stage?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Wow, what a captivating lecture, Mr. Mosana. Mine is a very quick one, and this is to give thanks to all of you, first of all, for being here. I just want to say all protocol observed and just mention that this is actually a very befitting lecture of our time, especially given the context and the season where we are at the moment. Now, linking this lecture, the theme that talks about leadership and local economic development, one cannot but think about the triple challenges of the country that we talked about earlier during those days, and one wonders if we are still there. And this was about poverty, unemployment, and inequality. We said we want to get rid of those. So when I looked at this theme, I just saw it fitting very well to that vision of the country as it appears in the National Development Plan. And also, just in honor of Archbishop Thabo Makgoba, I was also linking this to what is probably one of his values, and perhaps just quoting one of the books that he probably reads on a daily basis in 3 John 2, where the wish there, it says, "Brethren, I wish that you may prosper and be in good health as your soul prospers." And basically linking this to the core of this lecture, which is about economic development that talks to the prosperity of the people. Before the program director calls me to order, let me stick to my brief. University of Fort Hare. We would just like to thank you, Archbishop Thabo Makgoba. He's watching, right? Yes, and actually choosing us as the university to be the site of this very important lecture. Thank you very much. And also our thanks to go to the leadership of the university, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Sakhela Buhlungu, the MEC present here. I see DVC Teaching and Learning, Professor Vital, Reg, and also the leadership of the faculty, Professor Celia, the acting dean there, and as well as other members of the faculty and students who are present here today. I also want to pay speech to say thank you very much to the guest speaker of the day. Yo, wow, the lecture was very captivating and very thought-provoking. I think what I just want to highlight those competencies that you highlighted, that the leadership needs in order to lead, to be able to lead for local economic development. I think this is something that we all need. I mean, when you talk about understanding the context, the history of the people, and also being able to understand even the jewels that reside in everything in the locality where we are based. I mean, those are really very important. I would also like to thank the trust, the Archbishop Thabo Makgoba Development Trust and family as well. And also, I see the gentleman, Nyakolo, he has disappeared. Okay. Thank you very much again, Nyakolo, for gracing this very important event. Our stakeholders and partners in local economic development, the municipalities, Buffalo City, Amatole District Municipality, Raymond Mhlaba Local Municipality, thank you very much. I know together we will achieve this. There's still a lot that we need to do together, but we really need to continue so that we play a meaningful role in ensuring that indeed we play the role that we should be playing in local economic development. A special thanks also go to colleagues who helped in organizing this event, and among others, I just want to single out institutional advancement, and as well as every other person who helped to make this event a resounding success that it is. And last but not least, thank you very much, Madam Program Director, for your excellent facilitation as always. And thanks again, everyone. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof, for thanking me. In many instances, you know, people forget about the program director. We are now going to request everyone to stand for the national anthem. Once the national anthem is done, we will also start the academic procession, so we'll allow the academic procession to happen. Thank you. Thank you very much. National anthem. Procession song. Yeah, you know, technology, it can speed things and it can also slow things. But we are not behind time. We will wait for the technology.